Please join me in the opening sentences. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. The mercies of God never come to an end. Praise the Lord. The Lord's name be praised.
As we turn to a time of confession, we remember all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, yet we are justified by the gift of God's grace through the redemption that is ours in Christ Jesus. Trusting in God's mercy, let us confess our sin. Eternal God, our judge and redeemer, we confess that we have tried to hide from you, for we have done wrong. We have lived for ourselves and apart from you. We have turned from our neighbors and refused to bear the burden of others. We have ignored the pain of the world and passed by the hungry, the poor, and the oppressed. In your great mercy, forgive our sins and free us from selfishness, that we may choose your will and obey your commandments. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Friends, if we have died with Christ, we believe that we also live with him. Therefore, consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment, and a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." And so, my friends, hearing this good news, the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
And so now let us, in a socially distanced sort of way, pass the peace with our neighbors. So good morning, everyone. It is a pleasure to see you all this morning, and welcome to worship here at First and Central. I am also giving greetings to those who are joining us through the computer, who will be worshiping with us at another time, perhaps, but we are glad that you are with us as well, and thank you for being here. I have just a couple of quick announcements. There is on the back of the bulletin a full calendar of events for this week, but a couple of things to highlight. First of all, the Bible study on Tuesday morning at 8 a.m. It is done through Zoom, and this week Lyle Dykstra will be leading the conversation. So thank you, Lyle.
And then on Friday, as we prepare for a long holiday weekend, we also will gather here at 5:30 on the steps for our walk for justice and peace. This walk is one that we started last summer, and it has continued throughout the year, and so we hope that you will be able to join us this Friday at 5:30. And finally, as you leave worship this morning, you will see that there are offering plates in the back and up here in the front. If you would please leave an offering so that we can continue the work of this church. Thank you. Now let us quiet hearts and minds and prepare to hear the word of God from Grace this morning.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. O God, by your Holy Spirit, tell us what we need to hear and show us what we ought to do to obey Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The first scripture comes from the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians, chapter 8, verses 7 through 15. Now as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in utmost eagerness, and in our love for you, so we want you to excel also in this generous undertaking. I do not say this as a command, but I am testing the generousness of your love against the eagerness of others. For you know the generous act of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich. And in this matter I am giving my advice. It is appropriate for you who began last year not only to do something, but even to desire to do something. Now finish doing it, so that your eagerness may be matched by completing it according to your means. For it the eagerness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. I do not mean that there should be relief for others and pressure on you, but it is a question of a fair balance between your present abundance and their need, so that their abundance may be for your need, in order that there may be a fair balance, as it is written. The one who had much did not have too much, and the one who had little did not have too little. Holy wisdom, holy word.
Thank you.
The second scripture reading comes from the book of Mark, chapter 5, verses 21 through 43. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue, named Jairus, came when he saw him, fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her, so that she may be made well and live." So he went with him. And a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now then, there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians. She had spent all that she had, and she was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. For she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately her hemorrhages stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you? How can you say, 'Who touched me?'" He looked all around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some of people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha kum," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this, they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat. Holy wisdom, holy word.
So, none of us have been here for a while. I had the honor and the privilege of interning over the past academic year at Hanover, just on the other side of the Brandywine. And during the church internship, you're supposed to learn about your pastoral identity. What does it look like? Who are you as a pastor? What I learned is I am not a pastor who preaches to a camera. And so it is wonderful to preach to people I know, people who know me, and people who are sitting right in front of me. So thank you for this opportunity. Would you pray with me, please? Holy God, may the words I offer and the message that is heard be a faithful interpretation of your word to us today. Amen. With its intertwined stories, today's passage from Mark invites us to look for similarities and differences between Jairus and the hemorrhaging woman. We meet Jairus first. The leader of the synagogue makes his way through this crowd and falls at the feet of Jesus, begging him for healing for his daughter. And given his role in the synagogue, Jairus has status in the community. We know he's wealthy because his house has more than one room. He is married and has at least one child, but she is very ill, at the point of death, according to Jairus. But we do not know what has made her so ill. The woman, on the other hand, well, she's a woman. Unlike Jairus, she has no name. She is not wealthy, having spent all her money on physicians who have failed to cure her hemorrhages. And while the woman is not near death, as Jairus' daughter is, the text tells us that the woman is suffering and her condition has become worse now that she has sought medical care. The woman appears to be alone in the text. And unlike Jairus' daughter, she has no one to speak for her. And in spite of so many differences, Jairus and the woman are united by their desperate need for help. They have faith in Jesus' ability to heal, and they believe touch is an important component of that healing. Come and lay your hands on her, Jairus pleads. The text allows us to hear the inner thoughts of the woman who believes, if I but touch his clothes, I will be made well. But if we focus on the similarities and differences in these two stories, we miss the point. It's so easy to get caught up in this noisy, fast-paced narrative, this pace that is so common throughout the entire book of Mark. The author uses the word immediately more than 40 times, including 3 times in today's passage. But notice how the roar of the crowd fades as we imagine the woman's hand reaching out, maybe even trembling a little as she struggles to touch Jesus' robe. As her fingers make contact with the cloth of his robe, the scripture tells us immediately her hemorrhage stopped and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And leave it to the disciples. Oh, those disciples. Leave it to them to dampen a miraculous healing. They seem to have learned nothing, despite having direct access to Jesus in these early days of his ministry. They have already witnessed him cast out demons. He's healed one of their own mothers. He has even calmed the seas for them. And yet, they doubt that Jesus can discern the difference between the jostling crowd and the touch of someone desperate for help. And here, the narrative comes to a halt. The passage said, he looked all around to see who had done it. The crowd stands still. No one seems to breathe. But the woman comes forward fearful and trembling, not necessarily because she is filled with shame or doubt, but perhaps because she recognizes her life has changed now that her prayers have been answered. Not only has she been healed of her disease, she now understands the power of belief in this man called Jesus. She falls down before him, and the scripture says she told him the whole truth. She doesn't just say, "It was me, Jesus, I touched your robe." She told him the whole truth, her whole truth. We can only imagine what she said. Did she describe her life as it once was, the life she had before she started hemorrhaging? Did she share her frustration and increasing desperation as she spent all that she had on doctors? how she has grown worse over the past dozen years, and how tired, how bone-weary tired she is of being alone and afraid in her suffering. And as she tells him the whole truth, Jesus does something so simple and yet remarkable. He listens to her. He withholds judgment. He doesn't compare her situation to the other people he has healed. He recognizes her whole truth is not the same as anyone else's whole truth. He draws her in, holding space for her to express her whole experience, her unique life story, and in holding space for her, he acknowledges and validates her full humanity in all its joy and in all its suffering. And when she is finished, he reassures her, saying, "Daughter, daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." By referring to her as daughter, he restores her connection to the community around her. She is no longer the hemorrhaging woman alone in the crowd. No, she is part of the community. She is a beloved daughter surrounded by those who know her truth. And that is good news indeed, but the English translation pales in comparison to the Greek here. When Jesus speaks about being healed, the verb he uses in Greek is pronounced sozdo, which means something more than mere physical healing. New Testament scholar with the best name ever, Eugene Boring, love him. Eugene Boring defines the verb as deliverance from the enemies of life that threaten authentic existence. Later in Mark, the same verb, sozdo, is linked with eternal life and entering the kingdom of heaven. And so even when that verb describes physical healing, it's not restricted only to physical healing, but rather restoration to the fullness of life, both in this life and in the next. This woman who is desperate to bring an end to her bleeding. This woman lives out her faith by reaching beyond her 12 years of suffering to touch the robe of Jesus. She tells him her whole unvarnished truth, and Jesus provides not only physical healing, but also deliverance from the enemies of life that threaten authentic existence. He restores her to the fullness of life. And her healing is only half the story. While Jesus holds space for this woman, listening to her story, Jairus learns about his daughter's death. Jesus reminds the synagogue leader. He says, "You know, do not doubt, only believe." And he and a few disciples peel away from the crowd and head to Jairus's home. He meets some resistance along the way, but he is determined to get his disciples and the anxious parents into the room where the little girl lies. And just as with the first healing, human touch is important here. Jesus takes the little girl's hand and commands her to get up. And here I have to apologize, because the danger of having a new seminary graduate in the pulpit is you get more than one Greek lesson per sermon. So sorry. But the scripture tells us immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. And here the English fails us once again. It doesn't express the full meaning of the girl getting up. In the Greek, the verb egere means to rise or to get up, but not just in a physical way. Egere also refers to rising from the dead, as in resurrection. The original hearers of Mark's gospel would have likely made the connection between the little girl standing up and Christ's resurrection, and they would have made the connection to their own lives. And we too can make the connection to our own lives, because despite miraculous healings, these women are no different than any of us. Each of us will die, but we remember death does not get the last word. We live in a fast-paced world full of those immediate actions Mark's author is so fond of, and we live in a time filled with barriers that threaten authentic existence. Barriers built up by society, by laws, through fear, through ignorance, through the certainty that our way of life is the only way of life. This passage calls us to slow down and to reflect. When was the last time we listened to someone else's whole truth? When did we last withhold judgment, tamping down the temptation to compare and contrast another's life experience to ours? When did we last resist the urge to fill in the blanks while someone else was talking, assuming we already know their whole story? When have we held space for someone to share their whole truth? Do we dare risk it? Doing so means creating the opportunity for relationship. It means removing ourselves from the equation, decentering ourselves so that we begin to see the world through the eyes of someone other than us. Holding space for another means learning what they hold sacred, what gives their life meaning and purpose, what energizes them, and what frustrates them to pieces. It might mean hearing how they have been hurt by others, how a way of life we benefit from, one we take for granted, has actually harmed them. Do we dare listen to someone else's whole truth? Because once we take ourselves out of the equation, once we loosen our grip on our certainty about how others should live, we begin to see the full humanity of the other person, because relationships do that, don't they? Recognizing and honoring the full humanity of another person changes the way we see them, and that changes the way we see ourselves too. That change brings about restoration and healing in each of us and in our communities. And so perhaps these ancient interconnected stories call us to break down those human-made barriers to authentic existence. We are called to stop comparing and contrasting, to hold space, not only for folks who look like us and live like us and worship like us, but to learn the whole truth and to honor the full humanity of those whose lives do not resemble ours. And in hearing the whole truth of others, our faith reminds us that we cannot rest until we finally resolve the ways in which our society, our laws, our own fears, and yes, our own ignorance threaten the authentic existence of those around us. Just like the hemorrhaging woman and Jairus, we recognize each of us is in need of deliverance and restoration. And so maybe we begin to hold space for God, because it is God who knows our whole truth, all of it, even the parts we don't want to acknowledge for ourselves, even the parts we refuse to see. God knows our whole truth, and God offers deliverance from the enemies of life that threaten our authentic existence. God, who restores us to the fullness of life, here and now, and there and then. Through our faith, we know that death is not the last word for any of us. And so life everlasting for the woman, for Jairus's daughter, for each of us. That, my friends, that is good news indeed. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray.
Loving God, we give you thanks for the gifts of your creation, for the bountiful fruits and vegetables that grace our tables and nourish our lives. And yet we abuse our planet home, demanding more and more of it without tending to its own needs as it tends to ours. Guide us in the ways of stewardship so that we can begin to repair the damage we have done. We pray today for all who are grieving the loss of loved ones from gun violence, war, from viruses and diseases, from drug abuse, from suicide. Fill us with compassion as we hold space for their sadness, their questions, their memories, their doubt. We especially lift up the families and loved ones of those missing in Surfside, Florida this morning as they wait, worry, and pray. Keep safe those who put themselves in danger while searching the rubble for answers. Give them strength and courage, and fill them all with the peace only you can provide. We pray today for the ways in which our society, laws, ignorance, and fears continue to threaten the authentic existence of others. And we lament that there are religious leaders who have added their voices in dishonoring the humanity of people throughout history, misusing scripture to defend oppression and abuse. We recognize that our life experiences, while different, are our whole truth, and that you love every human, not because of who we are or what we do or who we love, but because we are. Give us the courage and the voice to speak for and to fight for the rights of those who cannot. Deliver us from our own certainty and guide us in the ways of peace, dignity, and truth for your whole human creation. And hear us now, O God, as we join our voices in offering the prayer Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Made you well. Get up and go in peace to hold space for those around you.
And so go, and as you do, may you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship and the communion of the Holy Spirit, now and evermore. Amen.